excerpt of De Finibus Bonorum et Malorum by Marcus Tullius Cicero, translated by James S. Reed, published 1883. To begin with the easiest opinions, let the theory of Epicurus first enter the arena. It is to most people thoroughly familiar, and you will perceive that I have set it forth with an exactness which is not commonly surpassed, even by the adherents of the school themselves. For my desire is to find truth, and not to confound, as it were, some opponent. Now the tenets of Epicurus concerning pleasure were once carefully advocated by Lucius Torquatus, a gentleman trained in every department of learning, and I replied to him, while Gaius Triarius, a particularly serious and well-instructed youth, was present at the debate. Well, both of them, having come to me in my villa at Cumae to pay their respects, we had at first a little conversation about literary matters, in which both took the greatest interest. Then, said Torquatus, I am quite of your opinion. Without adverse criticism there can indeed be no debate, nor is proper debate compatible with passion or obstinacy. But, if you do not object, I have a reply I should like to make to what you have said. Do you imagine, I answered, that I should have said what I did were I not anxious to hear from you? Do you prefer, then, that we should run over the whole system of Epicurus, or should confine the inquiry to the one subject of pleasure, on which the whole dispute turns? Well, said I, that must be as you decide. This is what I will do, then, said he. I will expound a single topic, and that the most important. Natural science I shall leave for another occasion, when certainly I will demonstrate to you not only our philosopher's doctrine of the swerving of the atoms and of the sun's size, but will show that very many blunders of Democritus have been criticized and set right by Epicurus. At present I shall speak concerning pleasure, though of course I have nothing new to say. Still, I am sure you will yourself yield to my arguments such as they are. You may be sure, said I, that I shall not be obstinate, and if you convince me of your propositions, I will freely give them my assent. I shall demonstrate them, he replied, if only you exhibit that impartiality which you promise. But I would rather deliver an uninterrupted speech than put or answer questions. As you please, said I. Then he began to speak. First, then, said he, I shall plead my case on the lines laid down by the founder of our school himself. I shall define the essence and features of the problem before us, not because I imagine you to be unacquainted with them, but with a view to the methodical progress of my speech. The problem before us, then, is, what is the climax and standard of things good? And this, in the opinion of all philosophers, must needs be such that we are bound to test all things by it, but the standard itself by nothing. Epicurus places this standard in pleasure, which he lays down to be the supreme good, while pain is the supreme evil, and he founds his proof of this on the following considerations. Every creature, as soon as it is born, seeks after pleasure and delights therein as its supreme good, while it recoils from pain as its supreme evil, and banishes that, so far as it can, from its own presence. And this it does while still uncorrupted, and while nature herself prompts unbiased and unaffected decisions. So he says we need no reasoning or debate to show why pleasure is matter for desire, pain for aversion. These facts, he thinks, are simply perceived, just as the fact that fire is hot, snow is white, and honey sweet, no one of which facts are we bound to support by elaborate arguments. It is enough merely to draw attention to the fact. And there is a difference between proof and formal argument on the one hand, and a slight hint and direction of the attention on the other. The one process reveals to us mysteries and things under a veil, so to speak. The other enables us to pronounce upon patent and evident facts. Moreover, seeing that if you deprive a man of his senses there is nothing left to him, it is inevitable that nature herself should be the arbiter of what is in accord with or opposed to nature. Now what facts does she grasp, or with what facts is her decision to seek or avoid any particular thing concerned? unless the facts of pleasure and pain. There are, however, some of our own school who want to state these principles with greater refinement, and who say that it is not enough to leave the question of good or evil to the decision of sense, but that thought and reasoning also enable us to understand both that pleasure in itself is matter for desire, and that pain is in itself matter for aversion. So they say that there lies in our minds a kind of natural and inbred conception leading us to feel that the one thing is fit for us to seek, the other to reject. Others again, with whom I agree, finding that many arguments are alleged by philosophers to prove that pleasure is not to be reckoned among things good, nor pain among things evil, judge that we ought not to be too confident about our case, and think that we should lead proof and argue carefully and carry on the debate about pleasure and pain by using the most elaborate reasonings. But that I may make plain to you the source of all the mistakes made by those who inveigh against pleasure and eulogize pain, I will unfold the whole system, and will set before you the very language held by that great discoverer of truth, and that master builder, if I may style him so, of the life of happiness. Surely, no one recoils from, or dislikes, or avoids pleasure in itself because it is pleasure, but because great pains come upon those who do not know how to follow pleasure rationally. Nor again is there any one who loves or pursues or wishes to win pain on its own account, merely because it is pain, but rather because circumstances sometimes occur which compel him to seek some great pleasure at the cost of exertion and pain. To come down to petty details, who among us ever undertakes any toilsome bodily exercise except in the hope of gaining some advantage from it? Who again would have any right to reproach either a man who desires to be surrounded by pleasure unaccompanied by any annoyance, or another man who shrinks from any pain which is not productive of pleasure? But in truth, we do blame and deem most deserving of righteous hatred the men who, enervated and deprived by the fascination of momentary pleasures, do not foresee the pains and troubles which are sure to befall them, because they are blinded by desire. And in the same error are involved those who prove traitors to their duties through effeminacy of spirit, I mean because they shun exertions and trouble. Now, it is easy and simple to mark the difference between these cases, for at our seasons of ease, when we have untrammeled freedom of choice, and when nothing debars us from the power of following the course that pleases us best, then pleasure is wholly a matter for our selection and pain for our rejection. On certain occasions, however, either through the inevitable call of duty or through stress of circumstances, it will often come to pass that we must put pleasures from us and must make no protest against annoyance. So, in such cases, the principle of selection adopted by the wise man is that he should either, by refusing certain pleasures, attain to other and greater pleasures, or by enduring pains, should ward off pain still more severe. Holding, as I do, this theory, what reason should I have for fearing that I may not be able to bring our Torquati into accord with it? You, a little while ago, showed at once your copious memory and your friendly and kindly feeling for me by quoting their examples. Yet you neither perverted me by eulogizing my ancestors, nor made me less vigorous in my reply. Now I ask, what interpretation do you put upon the actions of these men? Do you believe that they attacked the armed foe, or practiced such cruelty towards their own children and their own flesh and blood, absolutely without giving a thought to their own interest or their own advantage? Why, even the beasts do not act so as to produce such a tumult and confusion that we cannot see the purpose of their movements and attacks. Do you believe that men so exceptional achieved such great exploits from no motive whatever? What the motive was, I shall examine presently. Meanwhile, I shall maintain this, that if they performed those actions which are beyond question noble from some motive, their motive was not virtue apart from all else. He stripped the foe of his necklet. Yes, and he donned it himself to save his own life. But he faced a grave danger. Yes, with the whole army looking on. What did he gain by it? applause and affection, which are the strongest guarantees for passing life in freedom from fear. He punished his son with death. If purposelessly, I should be sorry to be descended from one so abominable and so cruel. But if he did it to enforce by his self-inflicted pain the law of military command, and by fear of punishment to control the army in the midst of a most critical war, then he had in view the preservation of his fellow countrymen, which he knew to involve his own. And these principles have a wide application. There is one field in which the eloquence of your school has been wont especially to vaunt itself, and your own eloquence in particular, for you are an eager investigator of the past. I mean the stories of illustrious and heroic men, and the applause of their actions, viewed as looking not to any reward, but to the inherent comeliness of morality. All such arguments are upset when once the principle of choice which I have just described has been established, whereby either pleasures are neglected for the purpose of obtaining pleasure still greater, or pains are incurred for the sake of escaping still greater pains. But let what has been said on this occasion suffice concerning the brilliant and famous actions of illustrious men. We shall indeed find a fitting opportunity by and by for discoursing about the tendency of all the virtues towards pleasure. At present, however, I shall show what is the essence and what are the characteristics of pleasure, so as to remove all confusion caused by ignorant people, and to make it clear how serious, how sober, how austere is that school which is esteemed to be pleasure-seeking, luxurious, and effeminate. For the pleasure which we pursue is not that alone which excites the natural constitution itself by a kind of sweetness, and of which the sensual enjoyment is attended by a kind of agreeableness. But we look upon the greatest pleasure as that which is enjoyed when all pain is removed. Now, inasmuch as whenever we are released from pain, we rejoice in the mere emancipation and freedom from all annoyance, and everything whereat we rejoice is equivalent to pleasure, just as everything whereat we are troubled is equivalent to pain. Therefore, the complete release from pain is rightly termed pleasure. For just as the mere removal of annoyance brings with it the realization of pleasure, whenever hunger and thirst have been banished by food and drink, so pain is removed. Now, inasmuch as whenever we are released from pain, we rejoice in the mere emancipation and freedom from all annoyance, and everything whereat we rejoice is equivalent to pleasure, just as everything whereat we are troubled is equivalent to pain. Therefore, the complete release from pain is rightly termed pleasure. For just as the mere removal of annoyance brings with it the realization of pleasure, whenever hunger and thirst have been banished by food and drink, so in every case the banishment of pain ensures its replacement by pleasure. Therefore, Epicurus refused to allow that there is any middle term between pain and pleasure, but was thought by some to be a middle term. The absence of all pain was not only itself pleasure, but the highest pleasure possible. Surely anyone who is conscious of his own condition must needs be either in a state of pleasure or in a state of pain. Epicurus thinks that the highest degree of pleasure is defined by the removal of all pain, so that pleasure may afterwards exhibit diversities and differences, but is incapable of increase or extension. But actually at Athens, as my father used to tell me, when he wittily and humorously ridiculed the Stoics, there is in the Ceramicus a statue of Chrysippus, sitting with his hand extended, which hand indicated that he was fond of the following little argument. Does your hand, being in the present condition, feel the lack of anything at all? Certainly of nothing. But if pleasure were the supreme good, it would feel a lack. I agree. Pleasure, then, is not the supreme good. My father used to say that even a statue would not talk in that way if it had power of speech. The inference is shrewd enough as against the Cyrenaics, but it does not touch Epicurus. For if the only pleasure were that which, as it were, tickles the senses, if I may say so, and attended by sweetness overflows them and insinuates itself into them, Neither the hand nor any other member would be able to rest satisfied with the absence of pain, apart from a joyous activity of pleasure. But if it is the highest pleasure, as Epicurus believes, to be in no pain, then the first admission that the hand in its then existing condition felt no lack was properly made to you, Chrysippus, but the second improperly, I mean that it would have felt a lack had pleasure been the supreme good, it would certainly feel no lack, and on this ground, that anything which is cut off from the state of pain is in the state of pleasure. Again, the truth that pleasure is the supreme good can be most easily apprehended from the following consideration. Let us imagine an individual in the enjoyment of pleasures great, numerous, and constant, both mental and bodily, with no pain to thwart or threaten them. I ask what circumstances can we describe as more excellent than these or more desirable? A man whose circumstances are such must needs possess, as well as other things, a robust mind subject to no fear of death or pain, because death is apart from sensation, and pain, when lasting, is usually slight. When oppressive, is of short duration, so that its temporariness reconciles us to its intensity, and its slightness to its continuance. When, in addition, we suppose that such a man is in no awe of the influence of the gods, and does not allow his past pleasures to slip away, but takes delight in constantly recalling them, what circumstance is it possible to add to these to make his condition better? Imagine, on the other hand, a man worn by the greatest mental and bodily pains which can befall a human being, with no hope before him that his lot will ever be lighter, and, moreover, destitute of pleasure, either actual or probable. What more pitiable object can be mentioned or imagined? But if a life replete with pains is above all things to be shunned, then surely the supreme evil is life accompanied by pain. And from this view it is a consistent inference that the climax of things good is life accompanied by pleasure. Nor indeed can our mind find any other ground whereon to take its stand, as though already at the goal. And all its fears and sorrows are comprised under the term pain. Nor is there any other thing besides which is able merely by its own character to cause us vexation or pangs. In addition to this, the germs of desire and aversion, and generally of action, originate either in pleasure or in pain. This being so, it is plain that all right and praiseworthy action has the life of pleasure for its aim. Now, inasmuch as the climax or goal or limit of things good, which the Greeks term telos, is that object which is not a means to the attainment of anything else, while all other things are a means to its attainment, we must allow that the climax of things good is to live agreeably. Those who find this good in virtue and virtue only, and dazzled by the glory of her name, fail to perceive what it is that nature craves, will be emancipated from heresy of the deepest dye, if they will deign to lend ear to Epicurus. For unless your grand and beautiful virtues were productive of pleasure, who would suppose them to be either meritorious or desirable? Yes, just as we regard with favor the physician's skill, not for his art's sake merely, but because we prize sound health, and just as the pilot's art is praised on utilitarian and not on artistic grounds, because it supplies the principles of good navigation, so wisdom, which we must hold to be the art of living, would be no object of desire if it were productive of no advantage. But it is in fact desired, because it is to us an architect that plans and accomplishes pleasure. You are now aware what kind of pleasure I mean, so the odium of the term must not shake the foundation of my argument. For seeing that the life of men is most of all troubled by ignorance about the goodness and badness of things, and on account of this blindness men are often robbed of the intensest pleasures, and also are racked by the severest mental pains, we must summon to our aid wisdom, that she may remove from us all alarms and passions, and, stripping us of our heedless confidence in all false imaginations, may offer herself as our surest guide to pleasure. Wisdom, indeed, is alone able to drive sadness from our minds, and to prevent us from quaking with fear, and if we sit at her feet, we may live in perfect calm, when once the heat of every passion has been cooled. Verily, the passions are unconscionable, and overthrow not merely individual men, but whole families, and often shake the foundations of the entire commonwealth. From passions spring enmities, divisions, strifes, rebellions, and wars. Nor do the passions only air their pride abroad. They do not merely attack others than ourselves in their blind onset, but even when imprisoned within our own breasts, they are at variance and strife with one another. And the inevitable result of this is life of the bitterest kind, so that the wise man alone, who has cut back and pruned away all vanity and delusion, can live contentedly within the bounds prescribed by nature, emancipated from all sorrow and from all fear. I ask, what classification is either more profitable or more suited to the life of happiness than that adopted by Epicurus? He affirmed that there is one class of passions which are both natural and needful, another class which are natural without being needful, a third class which are neither natural nor needful, and such are the conditions of these passions that the needful class are satisfied without much trouble or expenditure. Nor is it much that the natural passions crave, since nature herself makes such wealth as will satisfy her both easy of access and moderate in amount, and it is not possible to discover any boundary or limit to false passions. But if we see that all human life is agitated by confusion and ignorance, and that wisdom alone can redeem us from the violence of our lusts and from the menace of our fears, and alone can teach us to endure humbly even the outrages of fortune, and alone can guide us into every path which leads to peace and calm, why should we hesitate to say that wisdom is desirable in view of pleasures, and unwisdom to be shunned on account of annoyances? And on the same principles we shall assert that even temperance is not desirable for its own sake, but because it brings quiet to our hearts and soothes them and appeases them by a kind of harmony. Temperance is in truth the virtue which warns us to follow reason in dealing with the objects of desire or repugnance. Nor indeed is it enough to resolve what we are to do or omit, but we should also abide by our resolve. Most men, however, being unable to uphold and maintain a determination they have themselves made, are overmastered and enervated when the image of pleasure is thrust before their eyes, and surrender themselves to be bound by the chain of their lusts. Nor do they foresee what the issue will be, and so, for the sake of some paltry and needless pleasure, which would be procured by other means if they chose, and with which they might dispense and yet not suffer pain, rush sometimes into grievous diseases, sometimes into ruin, sometimes into disgrace, and often even become subject to the penalties imposed by the statutes and the courts. Men, however, whose aim is so to enjoy their pleasures that no pains may ensue in consequence of them, and who retain their own judgment, which prevents them from succumbing to pleasure and doing things which they feel should not be done, these achieve the greatest amount of pleasure by neglecting pleasure. Such men actually often suffer pain, fearing that, if they do not, they may incur greater pain. From these reflections, it is easily understood that intemperance, on the one hand, is not repugnant in and for itself, and on the other, that temperance is an object of desire, not because it flees from pleasures, but because it is followed by greater pleasures. The same principles will be found to apply to courage. For neither the performance of work nor the suffering of pain is in itself attractive, nor yet endurance, nor diligence, nor watchings, nor much praised industry itself. No, nor courage either, but but we devote ourselves to all such things for the purpose of passing our life in freedom from anxiety and alarm, and of emancipating both mind and body, so far as we can succeed in doing so, from annoyance. As in truth, on the one hand, the entire stability of a peaceful life is shaken by the fear of death, and it is wretched to succumb to pains and to bear them in an abject and feeble spirit, and many have, through such weaknesses of mind, brought ruin on their parents, many on their friends, and some on their country. So, on the other hand, a strong and exalted spirit is free from all solicitude and torment, as it thinks lightly of death, which brings those who are subject to it into the same state they were in before they were born. And such a spirit is so disciplined to encounter pains that it recalls how the most severe of them are terminated by death, while the slighter grant many seasons of rest, and those which lie between these two classes are under our control, so that if we find them endurable, we may tolerate them. If otherwise, we may, with an unruffled mind, make our exit from life when we find it disagreeable, as we would from a theater. These facts enable us to see that cowardice and weakness are not blamed, nor courage and endurance applauded for what they are in themselves, but that the former qualities are spurned because productive of pain, while the latter are sought because productive of pleasure. Justice still is left to complete our statement concerning the whole of virtue, but considerations nearly similar may be urged. Just as I have proved wisdom, temperance, and courage to be linked with pleasure, so that they cannot possibly by any means be sundered or severed from it, so we must deem of justice, which not only never injures any person, but, on the contrary, always produces some benefit, not solely by reason of its power and constitution, whereby it calms our minds, but also by inspiring hope that we shall lack none of the objects which nature, when uncorrupted, craves. And as recklessness and caprice and cowardice always torture the mind and always bring unrest and tumult, so, if wickedness has established itself in a man's mind, if, moreover, it has carried out any deed, however secretly it may have acted, yet it will never feel a trust that the action will always remain concealed. In most cases, the acts of wicked men are at first dogged by suspicion, then by talk and rumor, then by the prosecutor, then by the judge. Many have actually informed against themselves, as in your own consulship. But if there are any who seem to themselves to be sufficiently barricaded and fortified against all privity on the part of their fellow man, still they tremble before the privity of the gods, and imagine that the very cares by which their minds are devoured night and day are imposed upon them, with a view to their punishment by the eternal gods. Again, from wicked acts, what new influence can accrue tending to the diminution of annoyances, equal to that which tends to their increase, not only from consciousness of the actions themselves, but also from legal penalties and the hatred of the community? And yet some men exhibit no moderation in money-making, or office, or military command, or wantonness, or gluttony, or the remaining passions, which are not lessened, but rather intensified by the trophies of wickedness, so that such persons seem fit to be repressed rather than to be taught their error. True reason beckons men of properly sound mind to pursue justice, fairness, and honor, nor are acts of injustice advantageous to a man without eloquence or influence, who cannot easily succeed in what he attempts, nor maintain his success if he wins it. And large resources, either of wealth or of talent, suit better with the generous spirit, for those who exhibit this spirit attract to themselves goodwill and affection, which is very well calculated to ensure a peaceful life. And this is the truer, in that men have no reason for sinning. For the passions which proceed from nature are easily satisfied without committing any wrong, while we must not succumb to those which are groundless, since they yearn for nothing worthy of our craving, and more loss is involved in the mere fact of wrongdoing than profit in the result, so one would not be right in describing even justice as a thing to be wished for on its own account, but rather because it brings with it a very large amount of agreeableness. For to be the object of esteem and affection is agreeable just because it renders life safer and more replete with pleasures. Therefore, we think that wickedness should not be shunned, not alone on account of the disadvantages which fall to the lot of the wicked, but much rather because when it pervades a man's soul, it never permits him to breathe freely or to rest. But if the encomium passed even on the virtues themselves, over which the eloquence of all other philosophers especially runs riot, can find no vent unless it be referred to pleasure, and pleasure is the only thing which invites us to the pursuit of itself, and attracts us by reason of its own nature, then there can be no doubt that of all things good, pleasure is the supreme and ultimate good, and that a life of happiness means nothing else but a life attended by pleasure. I will concisely explain what are the corollaries of these sure and well-grounded opinions. People make no mistake about the standards of good and evil themselves, that is, about pleasure or pain, but err in these matters through ignorance of the means by which these results are to be brought about. Now, we admit that mental pleasures and pains spring from bodily pleasures and pains. So I allow what you alleged just now, that any of our school who differ from this opinion are out of court, and indeed I see there are many such, but unskilled thinkers. I grant that although mental pleasure brings us joy, and mental pain brings us trouble, yet each feeling takes its rise in the body, and is dependent on the body. Though it does not follow that the pleasures and pains of the mind do not greatly surpass those of the body. With the body, indeed, we can perceive only what is present to us at the moment, but with the mind, the past and future also. For granting that we feel just as great pain when our body is in pain, still mental pain may be very greatly intensified, if we imagine some everlasting and unbounded evil to be menacing us. And we may apply the same argument to pleasure, so that it is increased by the absence of such fears. By this time, so much at least is plain, that the intensest pleasure or the intensest annoyance felt in the mind exerts more influence on the happiness or wretchedness of life than either feeling when present for an equal space of time in the body. We refuse to believe, however, that when pleasure is removed, grief instantly ensues, excepting when, perchance, pain has taken the place of the pleasure. But we think, on the contrary, that we experience joy on the passing away of pains, even though none of that kind of pleasure which stirs the senses has taken their place. And from this it may be understood how great a pleasure it is to be without pain. But as we are elated by the blessings to which we look forward, so we delight in those which we call to memory. Fools, however, are tormented by the recollection of misfortunes. Wise men rejoice in keeping fresh the thankful recollection of their past blessings. Now it is in the power of our wills to bury our adversity in almost unbroken forgetfulness, and to agreeably and sweetly remind ourselves of our prosperity. But when we look with penetration and concentration of thought upon things that are past, then if those things are bad, grief usually ensues. If good, joy. What a noble and open and plain and straight avenue to a happy life, it being certain that nothing can be better for man than to be relieved of all pain and annoyance, and to have full enjoyment of the greatest pleasures, both of mind and of body. Do you not see how nothing is neglected which assists our life more easily to attain that which is its aim, the supreme good? Epicurus, The man whom you charge with being an extravagant devotee of pleasures cries aloud that no one can live agreeably unless he lives a wise, moral, and righteous life, and that no one can live a wise, moral, and righteous life without living agreeably. It is not possible for a community to be happy when there is rebellion, nor for a house when its masters are at strife. Much less can a mind at disaccord and at strife with itself taste any portion of pleasure undefiled and unimpeded. Nay, more, if the mind is always beset by desires, and designs which are recalcitrant and irreconcilable, it can never see a moment's rest or a moment's peace. But if agreeableness of life is thwarted by the more serious bodily diseases, how much more must it inevitably be thwarted by the diseases of the mind? Now the diseases of the mind are the measureless and false passions for riches, fame, power, and even for the lustful pleasures. To these are added griefs, troubles, sorrows, which devour the mind and wear it away with anxiety, because men do not comprehend that no pain should be felt in the mind, which is unconnected with an immediate or impending bodily pain. Nor indeed is there among fools any one who is not sick with some one of these diseases. There is none, therefore, who is not wretched. And there is also death, which always hangs over them like the stone over Tantalus. And again, superstition, which prevents those who are tinged by it from ever being able to rest. Moreover, they have no memories for their past good fortune, and no enjoyment of their present. They only wait for what is to come, and as this cannot but be uncertain, they are wasted with anguish and alarm. And they are tortured most of all when they become conscious, all too late, that their devotion to wealth or military power or influence or fame has been entirely in vain. For they achieve none of the pleasures which they ardently hoped to obtain, and so underwent numerous and severe exertions. Turn again to another class of man, trivial and pusillanimous, either always in despair about everything, or ill-willed, spiteful, morose, misanthropic, slanderous, unnatural. Others again are slaves to the frivolities of the lover. Others are aggressive, others reckless or impudent, while these same men are uncontrolled and inert, never persevering in their opinion. And for these reasons there never is in their life any intermission of annoyance. Therefore, neither can any fool be happy, nor any wise man fail to be happy. And we advocate these views far better and with much greater truth than do the Stoics, since they declare that nothing good exists excepting that vague phantom which they call morality, a title imposing rather than real. And that virtue, being founded on this morality, demands no pleasure and is satisfied with her own resources for the attainment of happiness. But these doctrines may be stated in a certain manner so as not merely to disarm our criticism, but actually to secure our sanction. For this is the way in which Epicurus represents the wise man as continually happy. He keeps his passions within bounds. About death, he is indifferent. He holds true views concerning the eternal gods, apart from all dread. He has no hesitation in crossing the boundary of life, if that be the better course. Furnished with these advantages, he is continually in a state of pleasure, and there is in truth no moment at which he does not experience more pleasures than pains. For he remembers the past with thankfulness, and the present is so much his own that he is aware of its importance and its agreeableness. Nor is he in dependence on the future, but awaits it while enjoying the present. He is also very far removed from those defects of character which I quoted a little time ago. And when he compares the fool's life with his own, he feels great pleasure. And pains, if any befall him, have never power enough to prevent the wise man from finding more reasons for joy than for vexation. It was indeed excellently said by Epicurus that fortune only in a small degree crosses the wise man's path, and that his greatest and most important undertakings are executed in accordance with his own design and his own principles, and that no greater pleasure can be reaped from a life which is without end in time than is reaped from this which we know to have its allotted end. He judged that the logic of your school possesses no efficacy, either for the amelioration of life or for the facilitation of debate. He laid the greatest stress on natural science. That branch of knowledge enables us to realize clearly the force of words and the natural conditions of speech and the theory of consistent and contradictory expressions. And when we have learned the constitution of the universe, we are relieved of superstition, are emancipated from the dread of death, are not agitated through ignorance of phenomena, from which ignorance, more than anything else, terrible panics often arise. Finally, our characters will also be improved when we have learned what it is that nature craves. Then again, if we grasp a firm knowledge of phenomena, and uphold that canon which almost fell from heaven into human ken, that test to which we are to bring all our judgments concerning things, we shall never succumb to any man's eloquence and abandon our opinions. Moreover, unless the constitution of the world is thoroughly understood, we shall by no means be able to justify the verdicts of our senses. Further, our mental perceptions all arise from our sensations. And if these are all to be true, as the system of Epicurus proves to us, then only will cognition and perception become possible. Now those who invalidate sensations and say that perception is altogether impossible cannot even clear the way for this very argument of theirs when they have thrust the senses aside. Moreover, when cognition and knowledge have been invalidated, every principle concerning the conduct of life and the performance of its business becomes invalidated. So, from natural science, we borrow courage to withstand the fear of death, and firmness to face superstitious dread, and tranquility of mind through the removal of ignorance concerning the mysteries of the world, and self-control arising from the elucidation of the nature of the passions and their different classes. And, as I showed just now, our leader again has established the canon and criterion of knowledge, and thus has imparted to us a method for marking off falsehood from truth. One topic remains which is of prime importance for this discussion, that relating to friendship, which you declare will cease to exist if pleasure be the supreme good. Yet Epicurus makes this declaration concerning it, that of all the aids to happiness procured for us by wisdom, none is greater than friendship, none more fruitful, none more delightful. Nor, in fact, did he sanction this view by his language alone, but much more by his life and actions and character. And the greatness of friendship is made evident by the imaginary stories of the ancients, in which, numerous and diversified as they are, and reaching back to extreme antiquity, scarce three pairs of friends are mentioned, so that beginning with Theseus, you end with Orestes. But in truth, within the limits of a single school, and that restricted in numbers, what great flocks of friends did Epicurus secure, and how great was that harmony of affection wherein they all agreed? And his example is followed by the Epicureans in our day also. But let us return to our theme. There is no need to speak of persons. I see, then, that friendship has been discussed by our school in three ways. Some, denying that the pleasures which affect our friends are in themselves as desirable to us as those we desire for ourselves, a view which certain persons think shakes the foundation of friendship, still defend their position, and in my opinion, easily escape from their difficulties. For they affirm that friendship, like the virtues of which we spoke already, cannot be dissociated from pleasure. Now, since isolation and a life without friends abound in treacheries and alarms, Reason herself advises us to procure friendships, by the acquisition of which the spirit is strengthened and cannot then be severed from the hope of achieving pleasures. And as enmity, spitefulness, scorn are opposed to pleasures, so friendships are not only the truest promoters, but are actually efficient causes of pleasures, as well to a man's friends as to himself. And friends not only have the immediate enjoyment of these pleasures, but are elated with hope as regards future and later times. Now, because we can by no means, apart from friendship, preserve the agreeableness of life, strong and unbroken, nor further can we maintain friendship itself unless we esteem our friends in the same degree as ourselves, on that account this principle is acted on in friendship. And so friendship is linked with pleasure. Truly, we both rejoice at the joy of our friends as much as at our own joy, and we are equally pained by their vexations. Therefore, the wise man will entertain the same feeling for his friend as for himself, and the very same efforts which he would undergo to procure his own pleasure, these he will undergo to procure that of his friend. And all that we said of the virtues to show how they always have their root in pleasures must be said over about friendship, for it was nobly declared by Epicurus, almost in these words, "It is one and the same feeling which strengthens the mind against the fear of eternal or lasting evil, and which clearly sees that in this actual span of life the protection afforded by friendship is the most powerful of all." There are, however, certain Epicureans who are somewhat more nervous in facing the reproaches of your school, but are still shrewd enough. These are afraid that if we suppose friendship to be desirable with a view to our own pleasure, friendship may appear to be altogether maimed, as it were. So they say that while the earliest meetings and associations and tendencies towards the establishment of familiarity do arise on account of pleasure, yet when experience has gradually produced intimacy, then affection ripens to such a degree that though no interest be served by the friendship, yet friends are loved in themselves and for their own sake. Again, if by familiarity we get to love localities, shrines, cities, the exercise ground, the park, dogs and horses, and exhibitions either of gymnastics or of combats with beasts, how much more easily and properly may this come about when our familiarity is with human beings? Men are found to say that there is a certain treaty of alliance which binds wise men not to esteem their friends less than they do themselves. Such alliance we not only understand to be possible, but often see it realized. And it is plain that nothing can be found more conducive to pleasantness of life than union of this kind. From all these different views, we may conclude that not only are the principles of friendship left unconstrained, if the supreme good be made to reside in pleasure, but that without this view, it is entirely impossible to discover a basis for friendship. Wherefore, if the doctrines I have stated are more dazzling and luminous than the sun itself, if they are draughts drawn from nature's spring, if our whole argument establishes its credit entirely by an appeal to our senses, that is to say, to witnesses who are untainted and unblemished, if speechless babes and even dumb beasts almost cry out that with nature for our governor and guide there is no good fortune but pleasure, no adverse fortune but pain, and their verdict upon these matters is neither perverted nor tainted, are we not bound to entertain the greatest gratitude for the man who, lending his ear to this voice of nature, as I may call it, grasped it in so strong and serious a spirit that he guided all thoroughly sober-minded men into the track of a peaceful, quiet, restful, happy life? And though you think him ill-educated, the reason is that he held no education of any worth, but such as promoted the ordered life of happiness. Was he the man to spend his time in conning poets, as I and Triarius do on your advice, when they afford no substantial benefit, and all the enjoyment they give is childish in kind? Or was he the man to waste himself, like Plato, upon music, geometry, mathematics, and astronomy, which not only start from false assumptions and so cannot be true, but if they were true, would not aid us one whit towards living a more agreeable, that is, a better life? Was he, I ask, the man to pursue those arts and thrust behind him the art of living? An art of such moment, so laborious too, and correspondingly rich in fruit? Epicurus, then, is not uneducated, but those persons are uninstructed who think that subjects which it is disgraceful to a boy not to have learned are to be learned through life into old age.
This audio presentation of a section of Cicero's Own Ends has been read to us by Joshua. The latest version of this audio will always be available at epicureanfriends.com, where you can join Joshua and others in studying and applying the philosophy of Epicurus.